And so, Simon, before we dive into stocks that our listeners should be watching, as I mentioned, you've been watching this space literally for years now. You've kind of seen it ebb and flow and grow. I want to start with one that you and I have talked about quite a bit. Of course, if you're a member of the Motley Fool, you're probably pretty familiar with this first stock. But the first one we're going to dive into is the gene sequencing giant Illumina. And for our listeners, that's ticker symbol ILMN. And more importantly, we're going to be actually focusing on its spinoff venture, which is Grail. Simon, what can you tell us about Illumina and Grail?
Illumina is the 800-pound gorilla in genomic sequencing. They are the largest player by far, Shannon. They did more than 90% of the world's high-throughput genomic sequences. Every year, for basically since their creation, they basically built upon this concept of next-generation sequencing. So doing genomic sequences faster and faster and at lower and lower costs. And that's how you've been able to see a whole genome sequence can be done for less than $1,000 today in a couple of hours, you know, and they're still saying that they have the architecture in place to get it below $100. And the reason this is so important is because for any of this to be financially feasible or even time feasible, we have to get those costs of sequencing lower and lower. It's information that's great for oncologists to have, but it has to be financially available to pay for. And that's something that Illumina has driven down the cost of sequencing for decades now.
And it's interesting, another stock we'll get to in a minute, actually most of their sequencing is done by Illumina's machines. So, I mean, if there was a stock that I think is a favorite among the fool, I think Illumina is definitely it. And I think what's really interesting with Illumina is this pan-cancer screening approach that they have. And so really, they're hoping to diagnose people at a very early stage, even before they have symptoms and irregardless of the cancer type. And honestly, looking at Illumina and this Grail approach that they're going after, they've got huge backers. So they've got some deep pockets to actually pull this off. What can you tell us about that, Simon?
Oh, my goodness. Yes, indeed. They've got everybody on board with this. Like you said, Shannon, Illumina kind of, one of the interesting things about this company, a lot of people think it's a race to the bottom, right? Is Illumina making any money if they keep pushing down the cost of a genomic test? And yes, they are. You know, they're making two-thirds of their money from basically consumable materials for each one of those runs. So as we see the volume continue to increase, more and more people doing genomic tests. We've seen the consumer DNA databases, Shannon. You know, these are the 23andMe's and the Ancestry.com's, basically the kits they send to your home. We've seen the subscriptions to those increase from 12 million people to 25 million people in just the last 7 months. So we're seeing this exponential increase in volume. That's very good for Illumina. The Illumina business, as you mentioned, the Grail side of this is more actually of the software data science play on it. Now that you have all of these genomes, how can you correlate between them to find a specific gene responsible for a specific condition? And Grail's first CEO was actually an ex-Google executive. You can just kind of see they're trying to make sense of this terabyte of data that comes from each genomic sequence that's done on those Illumina machines. And of course, the insight and the analytical approach to detect cancer very, very early stage before there's any symptoms is their goal. And you mentioned also the financial backers. They've got Jeff Bezos on board backing this company. Bill Gates is on board, J&J. And of course, Illumina themselves is on board with Grail. They just raised their Series C. They brought in $300 million from mostly Chinese companies. And there's even rumors, Shannon, that there might be an IPO for Grail within the next year, probably listed in Hong Kong. That's something I'm paying a lot of attention to right now.
Yeah, I heard that, which will be really interesting if it happens. And also, too, another key thing to watch is Grail has started putting out data related to this large-scale multi-center trial, and it's basically an observation trial. And so in order to have a population-wide screening test, Grail knows it needs to work on a very large scale with this trial. So the aim is to analyze blood samples from 10,000 patients, 7,000 with cancer, 3,000 with no known cancer, and basically build a library. And to your point, building out this huge database that they can then access and then continue to scale to hundreds of thousands of patients, with the goal being, can we start to detect and identify early signals way beyond symptoms, way before something is actually diagnosed? And so this trial is huge. It's ongoing right now. But I think a key area to watch is like how much are they able to enroll? And then what kind of data are they able to glean from that? And then more importantly, how can they turn that data into insights that then will actually tailor and customize a treatment plan for someone too?
Absolutely agree. And Shannon, they've already raised $1.5 billion through three rounds of funding. That's a huge amount of money for a private company. Just as you mentioned, they need a lot of data points, and that doesn't come for free.
Very true. Very expensive. And of course, our listeners who are healthcare investors, you know, even a small scale trial within the hundreds is literally billions of dollars. So let's actually turn our attention over to valuation from an Illumina's perspective, Simon. So Illumina, obviously a huge growth stock, has a market cap right now, $46 billion, trading at $316 a share. Even though it's a growth stock, do you still see opportunity here with the stock over the long term?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we were talking back when in the million-dollar portfolio days, our team would discuss about how the market was thinking that Illumina was overvalued at a $20 billion valuation. But again, you know, these things aren't happening linearly. It would be easy for an analyst to say, okay, we did this many genomic tests worldwide this year. We're going to do this many next year, then, you know, linearly increase the next year. That's simply not what we're seeing right now in the terms of the total number of sequences done out there. Up until the year 2014, there were less than 40,000 genomic sequences done worldwide out there for a whole genome sequence for a human being. And now, like we just said, there's 25 million just for the consumer DNA side of it. So this is something that's happening exponentially. Again, with Illumina capturing the majority of their money from those consumable materials, they've got such a lock, you know, more than 90% market share on this market. And you're starting to see those large precision medicine initiatives in the US, like the one you mentioned, Shannon, but also in UK, they're doing one. China's got their own precision medicine initiative. I mean, these are government-funded multi-billion-dollar projects, and they're all using Illumina's machines. I still personally think there's plenty of room for Illumina to continue to grow even at this valuation.
Yeah, I certainly agree there too. So let's actually shift gears and talk about the second stock that is extremely relevant in this space. And this is a larger name overall, international drug and diagnostic giant. And that company is Roche. And that's ticker symbol RHHBY. And they've really been beefing up their bets when it comes to personalized medicine. And really doing this in multiple avenues. But the one that has actually captured the most attention was their bolt-on acquisition of Foundation Medicine. Simon, of course, this stock doesn't get nearly as much attention as an Illumina does, but it sounds like they've got an interesting approach with Foundation Medicine.
A huge company too, you know, diagnostic side of the business, the drug making side of the business too. So they're very integrated and they've got a lot of resources and tools available to not only see what's going on with patients, but also prescribe those personalized drugs. And as you mentioned, Foundation Medicine was an investment that Roche had for years because they wanted to build out this database of customers' genomes so that they could say, okay, you know, it was originally tissue biopsies, Foundation Medicine was. And now they've moved within the last year to doing also those liquid biopsies like we mentioned before. And so again, the goal is to correlate between what is the patient looking like at the genetic level and then personalize the cure for them as well. Foundation has been a phenomenal investment for anybody who got in on this company. They IPO'd in 2013 at $18 a share, and then Roche just bought them out this last summer at $137 a share. Shannon, by my count, that's better than a seven-bagger in 5 years. Pretty good return for investors.
That's an excellent return. For our listeners, Todd Campbell was really singing the praises of Foundation Medicine for years, and we did certainly have to congratulate him on his early win here. But, you know, what's extremely interesting with Foundation Medicine and even with Roche and their approach. So very similar in that they're attempting to detect and identify early signs of cancer on the genetic level. But if you actually look back in history, Roche actually attempted a hostile takeout of Illumina. And I believe it was a $6.2 billion takeover bid, which Illumina, of course, fought back. And I mean, honestly, can you blame them? But it makes sense when now you see Roche really positioning themselves and being very strategic about Foundation Medicine. Simon, do you think with Foundation Medicine's approach and their platform, do you see any advantages compared to, let's say, Illumina and Grail? Are they doing anything different?
This is less of a swing for the fences than Grail is. I mean, Grail is basically trying to go for the whole enchilada. You know, when you look for, you know, patients with no symptoms, very, very early stage, there's a ton of work and a ton of money that's going to have to go into that. It will be interesting for me as an investor to see how independently Roche lets Foundation run. Is this simply a diagnostic tool that's available to oncologists that may or may not want to use Roche's developed drugs, the personalized drugs that they're creating? Or is it going to be more of a sales tactic to say, hey, we're still a drug maker, we're using Foundation to push more of our own drugs? And it'll be interesting to see the response between oncologists and Roche and how independently they run Foundation. But compared to Grail, I would say it's much less independent. It's much less of a swing for the fences. Again, a $5.3 billion valuation that Roche put on Foundation, that's a pretty good premium, even considering the Grail last evaluation round we saw, a private valuation, was at about $3.2 billion. So there's still a lot of growth, I think, for both of those companies. I think that in my mind, though, there's more of upside for Grail if they can figure out the technical challenges.
Yeah, and I will say to Foundation's credit, they actually secured a pretty nice Medicare reimbursement coverage. So right now, Medicare reimburses at an initial rate of $3,500 per test. And more importantly, Foundation Medicine estimates that only 150,000 of the 1 million Americans with advanced stage cancer are currently being screened. And it just goes to show, I mean, if screening becomes more of a standard for all cancer types early on, and maybe that's a part of when you go to your physician for regular checkups, there's a regular cancer screening, you can see the opportunity is huge. I saw some estimates, $12 to $15 billion market opportunity just for their Foundation One platform that they've been using. So this one will be a really interesting one to watch. I don't think, to your point, I don't think it'll be as much a swing for the fences as Grail, but certainly a formidable competitor.
Yeah, at 180,000 patients, that's nothing to sneeze at. That's a great database they have.
Yeah, and their test has been validated with 2,100 clinical samples and 4,200 analytical samples on top of that. So certainly they are up there. I think when it comes to Roche Foundation Medicine, certainly keep an eye on them because Grail will not be the only one in this particular market. Let's talk about the third stock here, Simon. So this one, compared to the other two, this is brand new to the markets, to the public markets. This is a company called Guardant Health. Just had their IPO. I believe it was earlier this month. The company sold 12.5 million shares, $19 a share each. And on its first day of trading, the stock soared almost 70%. And I think they raised about $238 million in their IPO debut. Of course, ticker symbol is GH. Simon, do you think this stock is worth the hype?
I will go out on a limb here, Shannon, and say, yes, I do think it is. There is definitely a lot of hype around this. And just in the last couple of days, I mean, the stock is up, what, Shannon, 25, 30% since we started talking about this. Not giving us necessarily credit for talking about it and that causing the spike, but still interesting to see so recently all the attention on Guardant. Again, they're also doing liquid biopsies. They've got now they've identified 73 different cancer-related gene mutations that they're screening for out there. They've got 70,000 patients. They're pretty well established. Both their CEO and their chairman previously founded companies that got bought by Illumina, which is an interesting and very important note, I feel like. But again, this is one that unlike Grail, they're taking a much more measured approach, I would say. Guardant is going after advanced stage cancer at first. They've got their cancer screen. They're building off of that advanced stage cancer to kind of go earlier and earlier in the diagnostic and detected and detection phases. But, you know, they've already got their screen approved by Medicare for non-small cell lung cancer, which is great, you know, very important cancer to test for. A lot of private insurers, Blue Cross Blue Shield, has already approved their tests. They're getting a lot of headway out there. And if they can do more and more tests and improve this screen that they have, I think there's plenty of room for them to run from their current valuation.
Yeah, absolutely. I think what makes Guardant so interesting is not only are they on the early detection and early prevention arena, but they're also looking at it from cancer reoccurrence. And so this is an area that does not get nearly as much attention. At this point of diagnosis, the initial diagnosis, yes, but for cancer that reoccurs, there's really not a ton of scientific data to really back up. When should you start treating? How should you treat the patient population? What's the best treatment to use in those circumstances? You see that in various indications, but not on a wide scale. And this is actually in addition to, you know, you mentioned the late stage liquid biopsies, but also too, I mean, that in and of itself is about a $6 billion opportunity, I read. The cancer reoccurrence detection market is a bigger opportunity, potentially about $15 billion here. So I think because they're going in with a slightly more narrow approach, right now looking at advanced cancer, but then looking at how can we apply that to various stages of where a patient is at, I think this makes this company particularly intriguing. And honestly, I have to agree, I think it's kind of worth the hype.
Yeah, and like you just mentioned, that's that measured approach, right? They've taken what they've learned from advanced stage cancer. You see them kind of moving earlier and earlier in the diagnostic stage screening. I think that's the right way to do this rather than to just go all in and try to bite too much off at the same time.
Yeah, so I have to ask, Simon, given that it just debuted on the markets, I know this was one stock when it came to valuation, it was a little bit harder to bite the bullet on. Tell me your hesitations there with how this stock is valued currently.
Yeah, so the real interesting thing is they've raised more than $500 million in funding, right, already. And most of that is actually from some heavy hitters that are not the public markets. You know, the IPO got a lot of attention, but 30% of ownership of this company is SoftBank, you know, who is, to be frank, kind of erratic on how they make investments and where they're going, where their view is for the future. They've got a very visionary CEO, a founder, but it's kind of hard to tell what SoftBank's intentions are sometimes. So they own 30% of the company. You've got Coastal Ventures and Sequoia Capital, both owning about 10% stakes too. Those are very, very well-renowned venture capitalists in Silicon Valley. But you add all that up, Shannon, that's 50% ownership of the company. The public owns a decent stake of this too. And institutions, you know, the Fidelities and the T. Rowe Prices of the world only own 6% of Guardant Health. So, you know, when that's kind of your critical, stable financial base for a company is these funds that are going to buy and hold for a long, long time. VCs aren't always known for buying and holding for a really long time. They've got their own investors and they have to have exit plans in place. So I think that's my hesitation as an equity investor in the public markets of what's going to happen if SoftBank or Sequoia or Coastal Ventures starts unloading a lot of shares. What's going to happen to the share price as of right now? I'm not saying that will happen, but that's definitely a hesitation, something we need to pay attention to. There could be a lot of volatility in Guardant's future.
Yeah, very well said, Simon. So to wrap things up, if you had to choose of these three, which would be your top pick?
I mean, my top pick every time I talk on the show with you guys is going to be Illumina. I think that the competitive position, the 800-pound gorilla in the room, is going to be right at the forefront of this trend of personalized healthcare. And I love them. And I've talked many times about how much I love them, so I won't belabor the point. I do think, though, that the one worth keeping an eye on for investors is still Guardant, just because we had such a recent IPO. And I still think a lot of analysts, especially those institutional analysts, haven't quite wrapped their head around this opportunity. And I tend to think that this being the disruptive field that it is, of personalized healthcare, I think once that starts sinking in, there's going to be a lot more institutional interest in that company. I think that could be very good for the stock price, too.